Hello and welcome to QBD Book Club. I'm Victoria Carthew, and what a way to kick off 2021. Crossing the globe, well, virtually, to hear the glorious accent of much-loved author Marian Keyes to chat about her very clever book, Grown Ups. Marian, welcome.
Thank you for having me, Victoria, and hello to everyone who's with us today.
You know, when I was trawling through the kind of dozens and dozens of articles about you doing lots of research, one thing that kept making me giggle, when it popped up, it said, Marian Keyes, an Irish writer of fiction, noted for its readability. And I thought, well, given that she sold 35 million copies of her books, it's probably obvious, but it's actually a really lovely comment, because to me that means that people really grab and embrace your books and you make them want to read.
Yeah, I mean, it sort of sounds like damning with faint praise, like readability. But look, I love when a book does all the work for me. Like I love when I've read a page and I'm already in, you know, I'm just taken away rather than have to kind of, you know, and I mean, obviously there are many books where like it's written so beautifully, but you've got to slow down and savor the words. But I suppose I'm a storyteller and I like the story to do the work.
Yeah, well, it absolutely does. And I think that's actually a really beautiful way to put it, because you are such a lovely storyteller. And you did that. You wrapped me up in the first few pages. Before we get into grown-ups, I want to talk to you about, I guess, the times we're living in at the moment. You know, in Australia, our lives are pretty different to from where you are and your part of the world. And books have played a really important role, haven't they, over the past sort of 12 months or so, keeping people quite sane.
Yeah, I mean, it was very interesting when, you know, when it all started about a year ago. Suddenly book sales went through the roof. But also I think people are more careful about what they read. I think I can only speak for myself. I am so raw at the moment. I'm sort of so kind of aware of, you know, the sorrow of the world. So there's a lot that I can't read at the moment, like nothing too dark. Like it's got to be hopeful, I suppose.
Actually, I think that's a really good point. You're right. I'm a little bit the same. And I think that's one of the things I enjoyed over summer when I was reading Grown Ups, is there's an element of this, some, you know, you deal with big issues, but there's some real positivity in there. And that has always been in your writing, hasn't it? You deal with big stuff, but there's a lot of positivity.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose, you know, because my own personal story, like I am, you know, at the age of 30, I ended up going to rehab for alcoholism. And like, I felt like my life was over. And it turned out that I was so wrong, and that like it was just about to start. And I'd started writing short stories just before I went to rehab, but it only really took off when I was out and sober. And I think I took that kind of sensibility into what I write, in that like life can be really, really, really tough, and things that you really didn't want to happen or didn't plan to happen, they'll happen. And it's what we do with them, I suppose. And, you know, like you can be really angry and you can be really sad and you're like allowed to feel all of those things. But eventually, you know, you've got to kind of move on and start living again. So, yeah, that kind of attitude, I suppose, always pops up in my books. And I'm, you know, I am notorious for my happy endings. And like that's something that I'm never going to change, because, you know, I really do believe it's possible that that things improve.
Absolutely. How have you found this time? It's obviously challenging in terms of the world and what's going on, but I've spoken to some authors who've taken the solitude. It's sort of served them well in terms of their work. How have you found it through this time? Have you been writing through this time?
I have been writing, but it's been up and down. At the beginning, I couldn't concentrate at all. I think that was very much a kind of a part of the start. People just couldn't concentrate because we were all so frightened. And then I had a good spell, you know, couple of months of like, this is great, no interruptions and everything. And then I realized, and like I would always call myself an introvert, like, and I'm always delighted, you know, if I get a text saying tonight is off. But suddenly I realized, like, I'm craving people, and like, because I, you know, dialogue is very important to me and kind of interaction between people. And suddenly realized I sort of used up all my people energy. Yes. And I need fresh infusion. But like we were out of lockdown briefly, kind of August and September. So I managed to kind of pack in a lot of socializing.
Yes.
Yeah. So I am writing again at the moment, and I seem to have enough to keep me going. I have petrol in the tank at the minute.
Fresh fodder.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Do you think we will see, given what's been going on, do you think we will see a lot of different types of stories and angles and yarns that are coming out of our authors in the next sort of year or two because of what they've seen and experienced?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I think at the moment, I mean, for me anyway, it's too close. I think maybe in 5 years we might be, you know, when this is all behind us and it's, and you know, and we can almost smile back affectionately at lockdown. Maybe then, you know, a novel about it might be fun to read. But I think right now, I mean, and like in Ireland, like we're badly locked down and we will be until May. You know, it's very hard to be affectionate about this whole thing. But then, you know, there are genuine love stories where like people decided, you know, they didn't know each other that well, like, you know, a romantic couple, and they decided that they would, that they do lockdown together. And like stories like that, like, are very uplifting, I think. But I suppose time will tell, really.
Your books are so observational in so many ways. You have a really beautiful way of snapshotting society and the big issues that are going on, not just the tough issues, but you know, you have a good laugh with things as well. How do you stay across all of those issues? Is it, do you stay a lot of, you know, is it social media? Is it reading news sites? How do you stay across the times?
Thank you. I mean, I'm on Twitter, and I think, you know, even though it is a hell site in many ways, it is incredibly of the moment. Like it's really, it's easy to pick up slang. It's easy to pick up issues that like probably wouldn't be mainstream. Like, I mean, one of the things that I write about in this book, like Nell is like really opposed to Airbnb because of how it affects local housing markets. And that really isn't written about in mainstream media, but it's all over Twitter. So stuff like that. And like, it's important to me not to be, I suppose, not to be desperately trying to be down with the kids. Like, yeah, if I'm going to write about things, that I have to do it, I don't know, with confidence and with authenticity. But, you know, I've always written about issues that affect women. And I think the world is constantly evolving, and that I, as a writer, have to keep pace with that in order to write accurately about what's affecting us now. So it's part of my job, I think, you know, and I do, I read, I subscribe to 3 papers and then, you know, read a whole load of other stuff as well. So that's probably it.
That's a really interesting observation, actually, because Twitter is exactly that. You see a funny issue, and if you don't understand it, you can read the threads, and then you learn a whole new kind of way of things are happening.
Yes. Yeah. And I mean, like, you know, there's a lot of bad about Twitter, but you're absolutely right in that things break there before they transition into the mainstream. And like, I love that. You know, I love feeling, oh, okay, I understand that now, and I didn't, or I know what they're talking about now. And I, you know, yeah.
That's it. And so that's one of the things I absolutely, so Grown Ups has a lot of characters. It's about a great big family. And I have to say, one of the things I adored, thank you, is at the beginning you gave us a family tree. And when I picked up that family tree, I thought, oh, that's funny. I wonder why. And about 4 chapters in, I was so grateful because I kept referring back. But I think the thing is, you write about people from quite elderly, you know, the grandparent generation, right through to the little kids. And you seemed to cross what mattered to each and every one of them. It was really wonderful because you felt like you understood the generations.
Oh God, I'm so glad. Thank you so much. The thing is, I don't have kids, but I have nieces and nephews aged between 20 and 0. So like, I spend a lot of time with them, and I'm interested in like, what do they care about? Like, or what are they talking about? You know, what matters to them? And also, I suppose I'm very close to my mother. Yeah, I mean, those people are all in my life, so their concerns are going to affect me. But thank you, that's really lovely.
I absolutely love it. Now, it is a commitment with 650 plus pages. Did you set out to make a book this big, or was it because you had so many great characters?
Yeah, I mean, Victoria, every book I write, I say, right, this one, I'm doing a nice short one for this one. And I really thought this one, I thought Grown Ups would be short because, you know, I had the idea of the plot before I had any of the characters. And I had this idea that like, I was just going to tell the plot fairly quickly and without getting into people's interior stuff a lot, but I can't help it. Like, I'm interested in what goes on in the part of us that we don't present to the outside world. And it just seems to be my thing that I can't write a short book, even though I try. And I've decided to kind of embrace it at this stage. This is who I am, and I don't seem to be able to do it any other way. So at least I say it's value for money. You get more page for your dollar.
When you read the blurb about the book, it tells you it's about the three, you know, the three Casey boys. But for me, it was just so much more about all of those women that came in and, you know, came in and out. And I really loved that you related to them all in different ways. And I couldn't say I'm one particular, although I really did love Jessie. I loved her and her madness and holiday planning and all of those things. But I love the way the women very much, it's about the boys, but it's actually about the women.
Yeah, I mean, thank you for that. Yeah, I mean, there are seven main characters and four of them are men. But I suppose the women do drive the story. And I love that you liked Jessie, because Jessie is quite a divisive character. I mean, I really love her because, like, she's this, God love her, you know, she's a control freak and, like, she's desperate to have the perfect family. And, you know, she likes everybody to be there. And, you know, I'm like that, you know, with my brothers and sisters and my nieces and nephews. Like, I like to have my clipboard and to be able to tick off everybody to make sure that they're all present. And yeah, poor Jessie, you know, I mean, my brothers and sisters call me her commandant, you know, because I'm so controlling. And so obviously I gave that aspect of myself to Jessie. But yeah, I love the way she's very kind. And
there's not a mean bone in her body, you know, that's the thing. Like, at the beginning, it's easy to think, oh, I'm to almost stereotype her, that she's going to be a certain type of woman. But you realise she actually means really well. And all the generous things she does aren't done to be showy or show-offy. She just actually means well. And I think that's why I kind of ended up loving her.
Oh, I'm so glad. I mean, I think, you know, the older I've got, the more I've realised that there are no real baddies in life. Well, very, very few, you know, and that, like, most, like, there's a little bit of good in the worst of us. And I think even with the best of people, we're all a tiny bit evil. And I think it's important to give those nuances to characters, that nobody can be a saint and nobody can be absolutely unredeemable.
I think the other thing that was really interesting, and you are known for your great female characters, is that the men in this book, the way we see them develop is not exactly how you might anticipate, but it also, I thought there was a really strong showing of what good men can be, and the lovely relationships you had with the older generation and the not so good relationships. But I thought it was really lovely the way you let those men develop.
Thank you so much. I mean, this is... You know, when I was younger, I was far more binary in how I regarded men. You know, they were either dreadful heartbreakers and players and cheaters and terrible, or else they were good. And as I've got older, I mean, and with my last book and also with this book, I realized that everybody is nuanced, and that it was really important to represent that with male characters. So it was, I mean, thank you for saying that they were nice. I mean, Jessie's husband, Johnny, on the outside, he is this alpha. You know, he's good looking and he has the chat and he's charming. And he would probably be the kind of man that I would have mistrusted or even despised when I was younger. And now I see his you know, his insecurities.
And you gave them layers, didn't you? Because that's what he
had. Yeah. His relationship with his dad is so not healthy, and he is still craving approval, even though he's nearly 50. And I think, yeah, that's one of the great gifts of getting older, in that I have been able to kind of view much more people with a more benign eye. So thank you. I'm delighted you found that.
Yeah, absolutely. Was the Muppet Show ever very big or popular in Ireland? The Muppet Show with Kermit the Frog? You know the old guys, Statler and Waldorf, who sat in the book? That's when I was reading the book, the kids reminded me of them, because they were constantly, you'd be going along and suddenly the kids would pipe up with a little, you know, Tilly, and they'd pop up with a little comment, a little snipe in the corner, and that's what would make me laugh and close and have to stop and come back. And I kept thinking, they're like the old blokes from the Muppets. They just kind of throw the best one-liners in.
Yeah, and they're so, like, without filter, you know, like they, thank you. Yeah, I mean... Like, I loved writing the kids as well.
Oh, they were funny. The things they overheard and the things they did. I actually, you kind of would like your own kids to be like that and deal with it so sensibly.
Yeah. I mean, you know, they are quite precocious, like especially Bridie, who I suppose is, she's the 12-year-old and she has all the signs of being, you know, her mother's daughter, like very organized, very bossy.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I have to say also, something that was fun for me was when I'm reading, I kept imagining with all the Irish names in there, I kept imagining the accents, and there are a couple of names I could never, and I've got a couple of Irish friends, so I would message her, can you ring me? How do I say this? Which is so, Shwashe.
Yusha.
And I'd say, how's this? She'd say, Yusha, it means freedom, or, you know, so she'd say, yeah. So I found that's a really lovely thing when you're reading.
Yeah, I mean, I picked Saoirse because of Saoirse Ronan, and I thought people who weren't Irish might be able to pronounce it, because I think it's actually, you know, not a good idea to put names in books that people can't pronounce, because I think it's harder to connect with a character if you're not sure what to call them. So I won't do that with Saoirse again.
I loved it because it made me, once I knew I was right, I loved it and I was with her.
Yeah.
It's excellent. Do you think I guess as a culture and as a society, we always think of Irish people as being so strong on family and sort of that big family thing. And I suppose Australians are a bit like that as well. It's a lot about family. That really was a real thread and a real essence throughout the book, wasn't it? That those family ties that bind.
Yeah, I mean, it probably is an Irish thing. It's part of other countries as well. But very much like, you know, I've got four brothers and sisters, and you know, we see each other a lot. I'm very close to my 20-year-old niece, and I'm very close to my mother. We get together a lot, and I kind of find it unusual that, you know, like my husband is English and they wouldn't get together in the same way. And I just think, why would you miss that? Like, I just, you know, my brothers and sisters, they're all strong personalities and we're not really alike. But that thing of being with each other kind of matters on a kind of a visceral level. Like, it's very important to me. Yeah, I just like the idea of, and like, again, everybody knows everything about you in Ireland. Like, it's impossible to have secrets. And that used to drive me insane. Like, you can't have an affair in Ireland. Like, if you go to the most remote hotel and you're having dinner with your sneaky person, like, your next door neighbor will walk in. It's just impossible. We're a very enmeshed society, and as I say, I couldn't stand it when I was younger. Now I love it.
Absolutely love it. Well, that's I loved one of the things I really adored about this as well is you talk about, you know, the pitfalls of being a grown up and is it time to grow up, and I think what it showed us as well is that life in a lot of ways now physically is so much easier, but all the things we do, we've made it really hard for ourselves. And I think that was the thing in this book, these people have a pretty good life, you know, like they're living well, but they actually made their lives pretty tricky, didn't they?
How do you mean, Victoria?
Just the choices they made, you know, the choices they were making, be it with their partners or the way they led their lives or choosing to not be as grown up as they should be.
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, definitely like Liam, who's the youngest brother, like he's 40, but like he's still like a 13-year-old. Like, you know, he is so immature and he's like constantly looking for his happiness outside of himself. Yeah. You know, and he thinks it's the job of his ex-wife or his wife or his kids or his job or his, you know, his brothers. And Johnny, who's the eldest brother, like, even though like he's like good looking and people like him, he is working for his wife and he feels, I suppose, demoralized and emasculated by that and doesn't know how to tell her. I think, and speaking for myself, that like that feeling of being grown up, when I was younger, I just thought like, when you're grown up, you'll never be afraid. You'll never have doubt about anything and you will be answerable to no one. And that doesn't happen really. You know, like, we kind of stay, you know, the facts or the circumstances of our life might change, but the power dynamics that surround us don't really change. We're always answerable to somebody. And it's always possible to be hurt. That was another thing I thought, that I would just outgrow feeling pain. That like I'd just get to a stage and I would be sort of zen and kind of, you know, hovering on this kind of blissy sort of stage where like nothing bothered me. And that's nonsense. Like I can still feel the way I felt when I was 13 or 7 or 21. That never really goes away.
Exactly what you put into your characters, because so many times you took them back. So many times you took them back to those places and they were back where they were all those years ago. So you really reflected yourself in that.
Yeah. I mean, I've realized one thing, well, many things about getting old, and that like the idea of closure is unrealistic, really, in that like any feeling I have ever had, it stays on file in me. And like, I mightn't be feeling it in the present day, but it's always available. It can always be retrieved from the database if a certain set of circumstances requires it. And when that used to happen to me, I used to think, oh no, like I haven't matured in any way. I haven't progressed. And that's the wrong way of looking at it. You know, I've managed to kind of box them for a long time. And I've functioned and thrived. And there's no shame in suddenly being able to access feelings from long ago, because that's how it is to be human.
I love it. You, before I let you go, I wanted to mention as well, you've always been very generous with your time with other writers or up and coming writers. And something you've been doing in the last little while is offering free courses to give people a hand in their writing.
Yeah, in January, we just gone back into lockdown here and in the UK, and January is like such a miserable month in the Northern Hemisphere. Like it's cold and it's dark and nobody has any money after Christmas, you know. And I was wondering, you know, I was wondering how to kind of do something to cheer people up. And I thought, well, the one thing I know how to do is I know how to write books. So I did sessions on Instagram Live, and I did four like tutorials, and I gave homework every day, and they're still up on Instagram Live if anybody is interested, and the daily challenges as well. And it was just like, I got so much out of it. I found it so enjoyable, so rewarding and uplifting. And just that feeling of connection with other people was really, really, you know, I got such a warm glow from it. And so many people, you know, because they'd been on furlough or they'd lost their jobs, they said like the daily challenge gave their day a structure. So like, I mean, that I got much more out of it than anybody else would have. I mean, you know, like that wasn't me being generous. Like I got all my reward.
It's good that you got a lot out of it, but that was very kind.
Oh, it was such a pleasure, like really and truly.
That's awesome. So people can still take a look, and that is still on Instagram Live. So what's coming up? You are, of course, promoting and talking about grown-ups, and it is a wonderful read. But what's next for you as well in terms of your writing, and what can we see in the near future?
Well, I have a radio show at the moment on Radio 4, BBC Radio 4. It's called Between Ourselves, and it's myself and an Irish comedian and actress and all-round good person, Tara Flynn. We're in conversation, and it's available on BBC Sounds if anybody wants to listen. And I am writing another book, which hopefully would be out around this time next year, if I keep my head down and keep working hard.
I don't think it sounds like you ever stop. Well, we are so thrilled that you could join us for QBD Book Club. And I know it's been a really difficult time, but we wish you and everyone where you are the very best in the next few months as you chase getting out of lockdown in May. And I hope the next few months bring joy and some joy. And I hope that things improve very, very quickly for you. And thank you for your wonderful book and sharing your time with us.
Oh my God, no, thank you, Victoria. And thank you everybody at QBD Books. And thank you for everyone who is watching. It's been such a pleasure. And thank you so much for your kindness.